Welcome to Lecture 1A. This time around, we'll be talking about digital imaging basics. What is a digital image? How does it work? What's Photoshop? How does it work? Pretty straightforward, right? So we'll jump in a little bit depth. This honestly is going to be a little bit more of a dense lecture than most. We won't be looking much at Photoshop here. We're going to be talking about the basics of how digital images function, how they display visual information, and keep that as a series of ones and zeros. It's a little complex. It may take some pausing and looking things up along the way. I intend for this to be a little bit interactive on your part, as far as I'm not going to tell you everything you need to know here. That doesn't sound ominous, does it? What I really want you to do is look some of this stuff up. If it doesn't make any sense, dig in a little bit. Ask questions. We have a forum for asking questions in this class. Please use it. All right, so as you're aware, I'm sure, a digital image is made up of a bunch of dots. They're called pixels. Pixel is a graphical element. It's a colored dot that has a certain brightness value. Pretty straightforward, right? You put enough of those dots together, you start getting an image. If any of you had a light bright when you were kids, that's the concept. Or if you took art classes and you did pointillism, kind of the same idea, I guess. But basically, if you put enough dots, you get a lot of information. Put a few dots, you don't get as much. That's resolution. So pretty straightforward there, hopefully. We'll look at some examples here. I have some pictures to show you too. So Photoshop's whole purpose as a program is to modify those individual pixels or groups of pixels. So that's what it does. It's a modifying program. Raster graphics, to add to the confusion here, is just another term for those images made up of pixels or dots. Another word for that is a bitmap. You have a map of bits, basically. So think of that. It's graphically laying out a bunch of different colored and brightness values of dots to create an image. So every single one of those pictures is stored digitally. Because it's a digital image, obviously every single pixel has to be described. So when you talk about an 8-megapixel image, that's roughly 8 million pixels. And there's data being stored on every single one of those pixels that says what color it is and how bright it is. So the more of those pixels, obviously the more data there is and the larger the file is going to be. That's a pretty straightforward concept as well. Hopefully you guys will get that. There are some file formats that work for raster or bitmap graphics, photos basically, or graphics, JPEG, GIF or GIF, TIFF files, BMP, PSD, the list goes on and on. There's a whole bunch that support pixels in images. That's what we're going to talk about the first half of the semester is pixel-based editing or raster editing in Photoshop. We'll get to the next kind, vectors, in a minute here. So like we said, digital images are composed of pixels. The dots that make those up or the bits that make those up are just that, they're bits. That's short for binary digit. If you've looked at binary or you have any idea or concept of what that is, you're familiar with a bunch of ones and zeros. You don't need to understand how to read or interpret binary. Obviously, that's what a computer's for, so don't worry about that. But you need to understand the basics of how that works because that determines a lot of information about your file. So using binary, the computer system is able to decide what values to assign to pixels and describe those. So using that information, you can use it in different combinations. A 2-bit per pixel image means you have either a 1 or a 0 for each pixel. And that means it's either black or white, every pixel. The image on the left of Mona Lisa is every dot is black or white. You can still get a fairly detailed image using different combinations of those black and whites. But if you convert that to an 8-bit image, that gives you a lot more gradation. You can have grays in between. So 2-bit, black or white, pretty straightforward. Technically, we describe that as a 1-bit image, black or white. 8 bits, that's grayscale. And you get 256 grayscale tones. You get black, white, and then a whole bunch of levels of gray in between that. We'll look at that a little bit more analytically on the next screen, but visually, this is what you're getting. All right, so here's where it gets a little bit dense. Some people this will make total sense to because you're mathematically oriented. I'm not one of those people, so stay tuned for a graphic on the next page that helps make it a little bit more clear, I think. So a binary digit or a bit, like I said, can be either 1 or a 0. That's either on or off. An 8-bit image means you have 8 positions that can either be on or off. Think of a light switch in a classroom or a building or an office or something. You got a light switch with 8 switches. And every single one of those can be either on or off. There's no sliders on the slide switch. Don't get complex here. But everyone can be on or off. So if I turn them all off, that's all zeros. That's 0000000000. That's 8 zeros, right? Or it can be 111111111. Anyway, 8 ones. You get the idea. Or any combination thereof. And you can see I started to type this out on that third bullet point. But it's 8 to the power of 2. If you want to do the math, that's 256 different combinations for every single pixel. So that gives you a whole lot of options. This is not actual. I mean, if you Google this and look it up, it's not true. I'm getting the concept across, not the actual. Like I said, we're not going to read binary here. But just use your imaginations. Let's pretend that all zeros is black and all ones is white. Okay. So everything in between that, all those other 255 levels, are going to be some shade of gray in between that. 0000001 is going to be really, 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 really dark black with just a tiny little bit of white in there, and so on. So brightness values are determined based on how many ones and zeros make that up, roughly. Again, don't worry about figuring it out exactly. We're just getting it close. Here's the visual representation. This should make a lot more sense. So our one-bit image, black or white, that's our gradient. If you look at a gradient that's just black and white, that's what it looks like there on the left. On the right, that's an 8-bit gradient. You have black to white, and then a subtle shift or transition throughout all those 250 shades of gray in between. Okay, straightforward, hopefully. Black and white. We're only talking about black and white so far, not color. We'll get to that later. All right, so pixel density, often termed resolution in your images, has to do with how many pixels are in how tight of a space. The second half of that sentence is important to remember. You can have a lot of pixels, but if they're spread out over large areas, you still have low resolution. It's how dense those pixels are, how many per inch, per centimeter, per kilometer, whatever it is, unit of measurement that you're using. It's all about density, not just the number of pixels, okay? So in printing, we use the term DPI, or dots per inch. In digital displays and in our file, Photoshop files and things, we're talking about pixels per inch, because that's pixels being displayed on a monitor or other output device. Printing, all your information is converted to dots, and that's something else we'll get to a little bit later on too. But visually, you can see the top graphic shows a low resolution scale there, obviously. Black and gray and black and gray, but not much resolution there in between. Below that, you see a little bit higher resolution. And if we were to take this further on, you could see it get smaller and smaller dots until the dots become indistinguishable. At that point, you get an image that starts to look sharp. You get the illusion of smooth lines and tones, even though when you look at any digital image close enough, it's just a bunch of squares, like the image on the left. That's really low resolution. You can discern every single pixel, and so you have jagged edges. On the right, all the dots are small enough that it looks like there are no dots. It's just a continuously toned image. So I said we get to color. Color is a little bit more complex to understand. Now color we get by combining three channels, so three 8-bit brightness levels, and we assign each of those brightness levels a different color. So if we have three 8-bit channels, one for red, one for green, one for blue, then we have 8 to the power of what? Math? Oh boy. We'll look at that in a second. Don't worry. But anyways, we get a lot more information in our file. Color files have a lot more information in them because we have to determine color using grayscale information. Binary, remember, it's composed of just ones and zeros. It gets a little bit complex to figure out how are you going to display color in something that only shows information about brightness. So when we assign brightness values, we assign them to grayscale channels that represent different colors. So an 8-bit grayscale channel for red, an 8-bit grayscale channel for green, an 8-bit grayscale channel for blue. And you can see on the right-hand side what those each look like. These are the actual channels of that Mona Lisa image. And see how the red is a little bit brighter on her skin and the blue is a little bit darker? There's more red pigment in the skin areas on that, and so on. You get the idea. Hopefully the green, the sky's a little bit brighter. There's a lot of green up in the sky. That's the basic idea there, is when you layer those together and assign those values, that's how you get color. So we'll do some exercises. I'm going to have you guys look at some digital images in Photoshop in the channels panel, and it'll hopefully start to make a little bit of sense. But think back to grade school when you mixed finger paints together. That was a little bit different color theory. If you put too many colors together there, you get just a mushy, gross, brown, greenish, blackish goo. In digital images, because we're working with emissive color, light is being emitted in certain wavelengths rather than in a pigment. It's being absorbed and sucked in. The more colors you mix together, the darker it gets. In digital, the more colors you mix together, the brighter it gets. So just kind of keep that in mind. But when we build up or stack those color channels on top of each other, that's where we get a full color image. And the combinations of colors that we can get is pretty staggering. We'll look at just the numbers here in a little bit. We'll come back to that. Before we do, though, I want to talk about vector graphics. So vector graphics are graphics or images that are made up of lines and curves, and it's all defined by math. Those of you who are not math majors in here, don't worry. Like me, we don't have to do any math in here. It's great. Programs do it all for us. It's all behind the scenes. No math involved. Well, very little math involved, hopefully. Anyways, so your images don't have any pixels in them at all if they're vector graphics. They're not bitmapped images. They're not raster. They're vector. They're made up of lines and segments with anchor points. So think of just drawing on a paper with a pen. You're making a line, and you put enough of those lines together, you can also come up with complex art too. It can also be very simple art. We'll look at examples of what those are here, but just to compare the two real quick, here's side by side of what they're good for. Vectors are good for things that don't need continuous tones. So vectors don't work for photographs, obviously, because that's not going to work. A line, by definition, is kind of a hard edge thing, and you can't make a continuous, can't make a gradient very well with just a line. Now, you can make gradients in Illustrator, don't get me wrong. So there's ways to do that. No big deal. But one of the big differences between the two is how it affects resolution. So in an image or a photograph, let's say it's an 8-megapixel image, we have a finite number of pixels. If we want to increase that and blow it up and print a poster, for example, out of a cell phone photo, we only have a certain number of pixels. And if we increase the size of that document, either those pixels get larger and start to become noticeable, or we have to tell Photoshop to resample the image, which is going to add a bunch of pixels in from somewhere. And there are algorithms that Photoshop uses to decide where to put those, but you're never going to get better quality by increasing the resolution of a file or upscaling a file if it's raster. If it's a vector, it's all determined by math. So think back to your graphing days in geometry class, maybe, where you have two points and a line that connects them, right? If you move those two points further apart, you just have a longer line connecting them. It doesn't affect anything, really. It's just mathematically determined. The line is longer. There's no difference in pixels or anything like that because your vector graphic doesn't contain any pixels. Vector graphics are great for web content as well. Things like the art for buttons and animations and websites. Web designs use vector graphics a lot. The nice thing about that too is the file size is not dependent on the number of pixels in them, and so you can have very low file size, which is great for bandwidth and load times and things like that. Here's maybe a better visual representation of the two. What you see on the right is a raster graphic. That little dot at scale, when it's tiny on top, that pink dot, looks like a perfect circle, right? But when you zoom in on it, you see it's actually made up of a bunch of little squares that vary in opacity to give you the illusion of seeing a circle. That's called anti-aliasing. We'll get to that later too. On the left-hand side, you've got a vector. Nice, smooth, curved line with a solid fill. It is a circle no matter how you zoom in on it. So that's the basic idea as far as the difference between raster and vector graphics. Vector graphics are resolution independent. We talked about this on the last slide, but hopefully that drives it home. This will be on the quiz. It'll be on the exam. It'll be on the final. It'll be, I'll send you a letter and ask you to confirm whether you know that or not or something. But this is one of the most important things, simple concept, but something you definitely need to take away from this class is the difference between raster and vector graphics. The two programs, as far as we're concerned with in this class, because they're the industry standards, are Photoshop and Illustrator. Photoshop does our raster editing, and Illustrator does our vector editing and creation as well. There are some other programs coming out. Affinity is another company that is making programs that do raster and vector editing. Affinity Photo is kind of a Photoshop competitor. They have Affinity Pro for the iPad Pro, and it looks pretty amazing. It's a mobile version of Photoshop, essentially. I bought it, but I haven't had a chance to play with it yet. So if you want to check that out, check out Affinity. They have some interesting stuff. And price-wise, they are a one-time purchase, not a subscription. And the price is pretty low comparatively. Curl Paint Shop is kind of, I knew some people that used to use that a lot professionally, but I don't know that it's used a whole lot anymore. Corel Draw, same thing. It can do a lot of the same things to a certain extent, but it's not the industry standard. If you're applying for jobs, those aren't the programs that you're going to list on your resume. You're going to want to have Adobe software. Okay, digital illustration in publishing. Unit 1 and Unit 2, these are how we're going to break up the semester. The first half, we're going to talk about Photoshop. The second half, we'll talk about Illustrator. There's going to be projects along the way each week where you'll cover the different techniques and things from the reading specifically. And then at the end of those units, you'll have an exam on Photoshop and Illustrator respectively, and a creative project respectively on each of those programs, where you'll kind of demonstrate that you've gotten everything cumulatively for that module, okay, or that unit. So for Photoshop, just to review one last time, where those files come from that you work with and where they go. Things from your camera, digital camera, whatever kind of camera that may be, cell phone to professional camera, medium format. Scans of slides or transparencies or negatives or documents, printed content or otherwise. Captured video. So digital video is all made up the same way with channels and binary and all the stuff that we talked about before. Artwork, hand-drawn stuff that's made in a tangible form on paper and scanned, or things that are made in other programs. There are some folks who are incredibly talented Photoshop illustrators and painters that rather than using vector artwork to do their sketches and painting, they do it in Photoshop because honestly, the two programs are very different and they're better for certain things and not so much for other things. But Photoshop can handle stuff from all over the place too. There are applications for Photoshop in medical imaging, MRIs and x-rays and things like that. There's functionality for stacked images, whatever you can think of, Photoshop can handle, and open and output all kinds of stuff. There's 3D files, 3D printing. You can print 3D files from out of Photoshop. Pretty interesting. Anyways, again, this is just a quick intro to some of the things that we're going to be covering. Hopefully it gives you a little bit of a better understanding of Photoshop's role and some of the digital imaging basics, and I'll let you guys take it from there.